What we wanted to achieve with this panel was to have a good mix of business perspectives, government perspectives, and also perhaps a little bit of the international organization and academic perspectives on a topic that is, I think, today extremely relevant and a topic that is given much attention, not least in the city where I'm working out of, in Geneva, in Switzerland, where you have the World Trade Organization. Last week we had a range of sessions during the WTO's public forum, and 2 years ago when they had this meeting, there were two sessions on e-commerce. This year we had 23 sessions. So it indicates that governments, businesses, academia, and the technical community are really keen on this topic. How is digitalization influencing international trade? And this is what we will be discussing today. And I hope that we will have today quite a good interaction among the panelists, and that we will have time to get the audience involved also in posting questions to these distinguished experts. So, I think we just perhaps should give a little bit of a background to where we are right now in the context of trade and ICT. As we have seen, the widespread use of ICT, from mobile phone use all the way to broadband, cloud computing, and so on, we have seen a much increased opportunity for enterprises and for people to take advantage of digitalization for trade. And of course, the immense increases in the capacity to process, store, and transmit data inside and across countries using the internet has completely revolutionized the possibilities for trading across borders. This is transforming business activities and, by extension, international trade. Let me give you just a few pointers with regard to electronic commerce, which is, of course, a very good illustration of the interface between technology and international trade. ANCTAD's most recent estimates suggest that global e-commerce is worth about $22 trillion. 90% of that is business-to-business transactions, and the rest is then business-to-consumers. Most is domestic, although cross-border e-commerce is growing very fast. Emerging economies are coming up strongly. China is already the number one market in the world for business-to-consumers e-commerce, with more than 400 million online shoppers. Brazil is also among the top 10 B2C e-commerce markets. But at the same time, we still have an immense digital divide, as was stressed yesterday by several speakers. More than 4 billion people are still not online. And if we look at the way that the internet is used in different parts of the world, we can talk about an e-commerce divide as well. The country with the largest numbers of online shoppers is Denmark, up in the north of Europe, where 79% of people are already buying things online. In the US, the equivalent figure is 69%. In China, it's 27%. Here in Brazil, 19%. And in Costa Rica, Mexico, and Bangladesh, and other many developing countries, it's less than 5%. So we have a situation here where everything between maybe 2% up to 80% of the population are buying things online. It illustrates the tremendous differences that we have around the world. But it also indicates the great potential for further growth of e-commerce and digital trade. And as has been stressed by many speakers yesterday and this morning, we're only at the beginning of this digital revolution. We will see continuous transformation of global value chains. We'll have the rise of new e-commerce marketplaces, increased use of cloud computing. We're moving towards more use of 3D printing, and the Internet of Things is expanding as we speak. These changes are transformative in nature, which means that it's creating massive opportunities for development and massive business opportunities. But it's also creating a lot of challenges, not least linked to what we heard in the previous session on the security side. This means that there will also be winners and there will be losers. But there's no question that this is happening, this is going to happen. So countries, companies, and people need to get prepared. not least in the context of the implications for their trade performance. So with that as a background, let's turn to the panelists and see what can we do to make sure that we harness this digitalization process towards inclusive trade and development to ensure that not only a few will benefit from this situation, but the great many. So let me turn first to Kati. How do you see the ongoing digital developments having an impact on trade? And perhaps what aspects of international trade do you see as most greatly affected by this?
Thanks very much, Torbjörn. Thank you all, and thank you, Witsa, for the invitation. Great to be here. Well, we've been very excited, those of us who have worked on international trade for a long time, very excited by the digital revolution. I think the trade community is bit by bit becoming much more aware of the power of digital technologies on trade and on small businesses in trade and on this kind of more inclusive trade. So let me kind of paint a very broad picture of how I think we've seen the world is, you know, 2005, about 10 years ago, Thomas Friedman wrote the book, The World is Flat. A lot of us remember that book. In many ways, that was shorthand for global supply chains built by large companies, you know, IBM, Dell, GE, oftentimes sourcing raw materials from around the world, getting inputs, parts and components from, say, Southeast Asia, assembling the final product in China, and then shipping it to the United States and Europe. And this kind of world of global value chains has captured the imagination of the international trade community. A lot of us have been just thinking about the policies and ways in which companies can tag on to value chains. And at the same time, if you look at how the world has been in this world of supply chains, it hasn't been that globalized at the end of the day. Most companies have never participated in trade. In Latin America, the average of number of companies that participate in trade is 13%. The rest sell solely in their domestic markets. Most trade has been generated, the volume of trade, by large multinationals, the so-called export superstar companies that are top 1% of the largest companies. We haven't had a lot of trade in services. Trade has been very much trade in intermediate products and manufactured products and so forth. And there has been a persistent home bias in the sense that companies that do engage in trade or FDI tend to do this regionally inside their own countries or regionally. Much of trade is still with partners with whom you share a border, international trade. Now with digitization, all of this is changing. So let me give you three big areas, and then I'm sure the other panelists have a lot of other thoughts. One is definitely e-commerce and online payments with that. When we look at data from eBay, and Hanne probably will elaborate on this, in Chile, the Brazil's neighbor here, we see that 18% of Chilean companies participate in exports. They export regularly. They export typically to 2 to 3 markets. If you look at Chilean online sellers on eBay, 100% of them export. They are all participating in trade on average to 28 markets. Incredible scalability, diversification for these little companies that are utilizing the global platform to participate in trade. I just did a survey with the Inter-American Development Bank of Latin American companies that sell online, whether on eBay or something else, or having their own online stores. The same pattern, 13% of companies in the brick and mortar world sell across borders. In the online world, over 50% of Latin American companies sell across borders, and 40% of their revenues come from cross-border trade. So it's a tremendous enabler. E-commerce, online payments, PayPal data show online payments are enabling SMEs in services to participate in trade. So I think there's much more kind of opportunities for SMEs to participate in trade, and you have also greater productivity gains for these companies. You know, Vietnamese companies that sell online have 75% higher productivity growth than Vietnamese companies that are online but don't have online stores. The other big transformation, if we kind of shift gears, is I think the global supply chains are changing. And this may take some leaps of faith. We don't have necessarily all the data that we might want to show this. But what I would suggest is kind of rebundling of production and unbundling of services. We have seen an unbundling of production, companies setting up these vast global supply chains. Now we have 3D printing, we have robotics, and what we're seeing is more and more localized production around major cities, in Beijing, in New Delhi, in Sao Paulo, where you have companies constructing factories that run on 3D printers. They print their parts and components on site, no trade, no transport costs, no supply chain management, no inventory costs, and they use robots to assemble the final product, whether it's vehicles, whether it's motorbikes, whether it's iPhones and so forth. And so much more streamlined production, much faster time to market, much less trade because of this. So I would, you know, I think there is also forecast there that in aircraft parts, in car parts, in electronics, in footwear, there is going to be a reduction of cross-border trade by virtue of 3D printing. Meanwhile, when you look at services, the cloud, you know, cloud computing is enabling much more of slicing of services out and unbundling of services, as well as micro-work platforms like Upwork and so forth. I wish we had more data, again, to illustrate this, but that's where the trend is going. And I think more and more of world trade is trading in services. And this entails that we'll have a better global division of labor and specialization as well going on. And the final note then, you know, wrapping this up, is the content of trade is changing. We'll have more services trade. We'll have more trade in bits and bytes, whether it's, you know, designs or digital products and so forth. We will have more trade in low-value items, parcels and so forth. And just as the fixed cost of trade are coming down, companies are sending many more parcels around the world than ever has been the case. Major surge in kind of small packages circulating in trade and low-value services. Now that 3 billion people are coming online by virtue of acquiring smartphones in the next 5 years, you're going to see low-value services provided to these folks, whether it's in education, online education, or banking, financial services, some business services like accounting. So a lot of transformations in the also in the content of what is trade, and this raises a whole host of policy issues and challenges that we'll probably go into.
Thank you, Cathy. Three very good illustrations of transformations that are occurring already. Anupam, in your wonderful book that I know that you like to talk about, the Electronic Silk Road, and I've read it, it's very good. You argue that digitalization is good for both richer and poorer nations. Please convince us, especially from a trade perspective.
Hi. So thanks, Torbjörn, and thanks, Witsa, for the invitation. It's a magnificent set of panels. So I do think that digitization is good for both the North and the South, the developed and the developing worlds. And so in for the developed world, of course, we see tremendous advances in the ways that people live, in entertainment, in all kinds of ways that we learn about what is going on in the world. But this is also true in the developing world. The developing world has finally been given access to much of the world's information and much of the world's products. And so whereas 100 years ago, perhaps in London, you could actually get most of the world's products, you couldn't do so sitting in Brasilia 50 years ago, and you couldn't do so sitting in Sao Paulo even 50 years ago, right? And so now, today, you can get access to the world's riches and information from the world over. And in the developing world, it's allowed people to leapfrog stages of development. So now with the rise of the smartphone, people have intelligent computers in their hands, and they could be riding a bicycle in Kenya or New Delhi, and they would still be connected to the world. They would have information for fishermen about market prices so that they can actually better deal with buyers, so they can get the best, they understand what the markets are asking, and they can deliver products that are best suited to the market and attain more of the gains from trade themselves. So I think it's been a tremendously powerful tool to advance companies and individuals across the world. Think about banking. In much of the world, people don't have bank accounts, right? So we in this room are all very privileged to have bank accounts. Most people can't even access a bank account because they don't have, for example, any kind of persistent identifiers that make it easy for banks to be able to confirm their identity. Now with the rise of a smartphone, people have been able to get access to financial services to, you know, when people didn't have credit cards or debit cards, now they can actually store value and enter into exchanges with people all over the world. So I actually think it's been tremendously valuable to the developing world as well as the developed world. And finally, think about the major forces of the last 100 years, the rise in global supply chains that Kati mentioned. So we've seen over the 20th century, liberalization in trade and goods. Barriers to goods trade have fallen dramatically. But yet barriers to trade and services still persist. And so as we see barriers to trade and services fall, we're going to see more and more people enter global competition for services. And that's going to enhance the power of people, of well-educated people all across the world who don't now have to travel to London or New York to deliver their services, but can do so from wherever they are, whether they're sitting in Costa Rica or whether they're sitting in Brasilia. So I think it's, again, tremendously powerful for empowering the people of the world.
All right. Thank you very much. Now, Hanne, as the Director of Global Policy at eBay, Global Public Policy at eBay, you keep thinking a lot about these issues, I would imagine. And Kati already mentioned this point of bringing in the smaller businesses into the world of e-commerce and digital trade. How do you see the e-commerce changing the opportunities for micro enterprises and perhaps smaller businesses to actually engage in these kind of activities?
Yes, yeah. So thank you, of course, Torbjörn, and I'm very happy to be here at this conference. Let me try and land somewhere in between Anupman and Kati. So I think e-commerce and e-trade is an example. It's showing what is possible. It's showing the opportunities that the digital economy can bring. Because what it's showing is that technology and the internet can empower micro, the very small businesses, to expand their operations, to reach and serve customers globally. Am I coming out clear, or is it going round the sound? Okay. Yep. I think it was in 2005, so Hal Varian, so he was then dean at Berkeley University, he's now chief economist at Google, so he wrote an article where he coined the term micro-multinationals. So in his article, he was describing a new phenomenon. So this new phenomenon of small businesses leveraging the internet, leveraging technology to locate employees and access customers worldwide. And when he wrote the article in 2005, he didn't have much data to back up his statements. But in the area of e-commerce, the data is now coming in. Kati cited some of these data. We at eBay have been sort of using the data we have, transaction data, to try and understand what is going on. And we've found that almost irrespective of where we look, even, you know, there might be an eBay site there, there might not be an eBay site there, but small businesses are taking advantage of our marketplace to sell internationally. We recently looked at 18 countries, 9 emerging and 9 advanced economies. Mexico, Colombia, Brazil, and Chile were part of them. And we did find that the average number of countries, sellers from those countries served, were actually 27. So one country lower than Kati's. And what's happening here is that trade costs are going down. So you look at traditional trade economic research, and for years and years, you find that with distance, trade decreases. So you increase distance between the trade participants and trade drops. We see that looking at online trade, that drop is much lower. So you increase distance, but trade still happens. We've estimated that trade costs are about 6 times lower online. And this is mainly because of information, communication, and trust being facilitated online. Because some of the main costs are still there, such as shipping. Some new arise, such as language. But nevertheless, being able to communicate, being able to access information, being able to create trust between parties, that really matters. So that's what we see happening, trade costs coming down. And to give you an example of what it means when small businesses are able to internationalize, we looked at the ability of online small businesses, the ability of them to navigate economic downturns, so when demand suddenly drops. And we did this in Europe because we were trying to replicate with our data a research piece that the European Commission had done. So they have looked at how companies, different size classes, adapted to the fact that during the recent economic and financial crisis in Europe, demand dropped. So across Europe, demand dropped. But demand rose from outside. And what this research found was that large companies were able to adapt. They were able to shift their exporting to non-EU destinations. Microbusinesses, small businesses, and medium-sized businesses, they were not able to do that. They weren't able to capture demand and offset drop in demand. When we looked at online businesses, we found that they were more nimble, more flexible, and more capable than the large firms. So their ability to internationalize gave them this ability to navigate economic downturns. So just summing up what I see, the advantages of e-commerce is internationalization no longer being dependent upon size, upon financial muscles, upon human resources. It's becoming something that the smallest business can engage in. And it's becoming something that the smallest business, irrespective of where it is located, can engage in. As I said, we've looked at almost every country in the world. We looked at emerging, we looked at advanced economies. We've also looked at different parts of a region. We did this in Europe. We compared, you know, how are businesses in a city like London compared to in the more remote parts of a country performing. And we found that they are just as capable exporting, building international businesses if they are based in a region with lower population, with lower GDP. So I would say those are the advantages.
Right. Thank you so much, Hanne. Now, so we have heard from like a business academic perspective here that there are clearly opportunities here and they are happening fast. So let me turn now to Minister Mora. As Minister for Foreign Trade, what can you and your colleagues in the rest of the government do in Costa Rica to harness digitalization for trade and development? What can you do perhaps in your own country and perhaps in partnership with other countries at the international level?
Thank you very much, Torben, for having me here, and thank you very much to the Brazilian fellows for hosting this event, to WITSA, and to the rest of the organizations behind this important event for the initiative. Before answering your question, Torvan, I would like to ask a question to the audience. I want to know how many of you in the audience are policymakers. Can you raise your hands, please? Government officials or from Brazil or other countries. So it's a minority, as you can see. So I'm going to address your question in a more neutral way. I have been, since many years back, criticizing the idea that the trade agenda and the digital agenda are not linked. And this is the fault of the public sector, because the private sector has been telling public sector and governments all over the world that we need to link these two agendas. But the fact is that we are far away from that position. I think that some countries are already moving in that direction. I just visited recently Israel. I know they are doing a great job in that direction. But developing countries in general, we are not doing a good job in that area. So my focus from the capacities that we have in the public service is to build up public policy to link these two agendas. And there are many instruments. But as I come from the private sector and I have been only in public sector for the last 2 years, and I have been in many world congresses sitting just here in the audience, just like you are now, my approach and the suggestion I have for other fellows in public sector is to have a clear understanding of where you're coming from. If I come to Costa Rica and I analyze and I see where we are, I see a very small country with an extremely open foreign trade platform. Costa Rica has free trade agreements with 60 countries in the world, including China, which means that we can put our products and services with preferential access in 2/3 of the world's GDP, 2.8 billion potential customers. And that enormous platform has a low potential, but SMEs in particular are not beneficiating from that potential. So I focus my initiatives on SMEs. With large corporations, there is a separate strategy. And the strategy is more creating the stability and the right setting or right business climate for them to invest in the country. And we're doing very well. In fact, 75% of the new projects that are developed in the country by multinational companies are high-tech projects. 46% of services, of corporate services out of Latin America, including Mexico and Brazil, that are exporting overseas, I mean, outside the region, are developing Costa Rica. Same thing with ICT. 42% of the services that the Latin America region as a whole, including Brazil and Mexico, are exporting outside the Latin America region are based in Costa Rica. So this is a great success for us. But this is separate because the SMEs are not doing well. So we're linking, doing a strong support to SMEs to link with multinational companies as suppliers. That's one part of the policy. The other part of the policy is helping SMEs to reach niches, specific niches in the global market. And e-trade or e-commerce is a great tool to reach niches, because otherwise it's very hard for a small company to try to be in the market. So the way e-trade is serving as a tool for these SMEs to reach niches is the core of our public policy. The Trade Promotion Agency, National Trade Promotion Agency, is now focused on this initiative. So we developed this interface. This interface is linked with eBay, is linked with Alibaba, is linked with Amazon, is linked with 17 different e-trade platforms. And we are providing free access to SMEs to this national platform we call Costa Rica Direct. And then each of them can adjust their offer to these different platforms and to different niches they want to reach. At the very end, what businesses are looking for is to reduce cost and to reach new markets. So we are focusing on specific services to do so. And on the other side, at higher political level, we have a group, a network to support this initiative, including the Ministry of Science and Technology, the Ministry of the Economy, Ministry of Agriculture, Ministry of Labor, in order to provide all the additional services that the SMEs will require to succeed in this strategy. I will concentrate on those specifics at this stage, and then I would like to mention a few other ideas at multilateral level.
Okay.
Thank you.
That'll be great. Thank you. Anupam, following up on Minister Mora's intervention here, what do you see as the main impediments to reaping greater benefits from digitalization in developing countries? And I can add also a question. Do you see, considering that you're a professor of law, any role for trade law in this context?
Great. So let me identify, I think, three impediments, two of which are regulatory that involve trade law, and one of which I think is more about practice. So the first is the concept of data localization, which is a concept that says information can only be safe if it's stored in our country. If it goes abroad, the information is now going to be gobbled up by thieves and foreign security services, and it becomes unsafe and insecure. Okay. That's one of the claims about data localization. And there's a logic to data localization, which goes along the following lines. If I build up walls and keep the information in, then I will grow my industry because I will now supply these services locally inside my country and keep out foreigners from my country. Okay. But of course, anytime you build a wall, you're likely not to make that wall only a one-way wall. Other people outside will build walls to stop your information from coming in. Brazil, in fact, thought about this, as you're probably familiar. In the Marco Civil, in the draft in Parliament, there was a proposal, actually, that would have allowed the president to declare some information to be mandated to stay in the country. Okay, so there was a kind of open license for the executive to declare whatever information the executive wanted to be localized. And so that was removed when Brazil realized, I think, properly, that it wanted to export services to the rest of the world as well. It didn't just want to create only for the Brazilian market. It wanted to build for the world. And it wouldn't also be able to access then services provided from around the world. So we have the example of PayPal, which this year announced that it wasn't going to build out in Turkey because of Turkey's efforts to force data localization. So, you know, PayPal decides to quit Turkey rather than invest in Turkey because of these kinds of problems. So I think data localization is a serious concern. We've seen some suggestions that in Europe, the European efforts to force local data have resulted in American companies spending lots of money in Europe to build out server farms. How many of you here have visited a server farm? How many human beings did you see in the server farm? I get two. These are enormous warehouses, and what are they? Racks and racks of computers. A country like Brazil is not the one producing those computers. The server farm is literally imported from the United States and China, principally. Right. So even if there's a huge investment in the server farm, the investment simply consists in building a warehouse, employing a couple people, employing the people who built the warehouse and things like that. And there are people who will replace the computers when they go down. But largely, it's a computerized operation. And it doesn't actually create lots of local ongoing investment. In fact, what it creates is ongoing demands on local power systems. That's the main cost of running a data center, is the power systems and then replacing failing computers, right? So unless you're a big computer manufacturer, you're not likely to see much in the way of sales by hosting a data center. So I think data localization is one of these regulatory problems. A second regulatory problem are generally all the various licensing requirements in order to provide various services. These licensing requirements can be can be based on municipalities, can be based on states or provinces, and can also be at the national level. And they create a very complicated regulatory thicket for service providers to navigate. It makes it hard for companies to be able to offer services to other countries. Minister Mora talked about providing niche services across the world, which is exactly what e-commerce allows one to do. You identify the niche that's desired across the world and you provide it. But if there are regulatory obstacles to foreigners providing those services, that makes it very hard to do so. So Costa Rica stands to be one of these, you know, centers of providing services for the world, but it has to be able to do so on a regulatory basis. And both of those issues, I think, are tractable under international trade law. International trade law tries to stop discrimination against foreign producers. That's its fundamental raison d'etre. Its goal is to say, hey, it's perfectly fine that you want privacy. It's perfectly fine that you want food safety, your typical original kind of idea in international trade law. But the fact is that you can buy safe food from Mexico or the United States or from Brazil. And food can be safe or unsafe in whatever jurisdiction it's produced in. And just as privacy and consumer protection can be made safe regardless of what jurisdiction they are produced in, you have to insist on privacy and safety and consumer protection and security. But you can do so even if you have global trade, just as we've done with our food system. We've said you can have food from abroad. We can send food abroad. And we will do so demanding safety, regardless of where it comes from. So the third and final thing, I'll just end here quickly, is I think marketing. One of the challenges that Minister Mora faces is his companies have to know how to market themselves to overseas customers. He may have the best service providers. He may have the best goods manufacturers, but other people need to know who they are. And this is a question of Sumitra Dutta yesterday described the need for a branding exercise by countries. Minister Mora's presence here is part of that branding exercise, clearly, for Costa Rica. And I commend him for that. But I think this is a very important part of the exercise as well. Marketing, teaching companies how to understand the foreign market, how to reach the foreign market. When you have SMEs, they may not have the sophistication to to sign contracts internationally. They may not know how to engage and protect privacy internationally or security internationally. And so these are things that that governments can help with, that industry can help with, by creating guidelines and practices and sharing knowledge.
All right. Super. Thank you, Anupam. Hannah, at the far end, I can hardly see you. Some people would talk about the traditional trade and eBay trade or the like. What would be your recommendations to policymakers to seize these opportunities now? What should they prioritize?
First, I would not talk about eBay trade. What I tried to describe was a technology-enabled trade. And I think Katie did a very good job at sort of differentiating between traditional trade and technology-enabled trade. Just simplifying, traditional trade being dominated by large firms shipping to a few countries, technology-enabled trade being open to small businesses transacting directly, not having actually to go through a large firm's value chain, and then serving a large number of countries. So very simple, I would see the difference as having limited number of known traders compared to unlimited number of unknown traders. So when you think about policy for this world, I think that worldview is important to have in mind. And I was very impressed by what Alex was describing, what's being done in Costa Rica. And I think these are that type of practical project approach is one that countries should take. Some years ago, I was having discussions with the Swedish government because they were in the process of creating their trade strategy. And my suggestion was to have a sort of an e-trade plan along the lines of what Costa Rica has, where you would set an ambitious goal, you would identify the focus areas for realizing that goal, and then involving the both private and public sector partners that you need to address those focus areas. So just take an example, and again, just starting with Sweden, because it's the way the economy in terms of retailers exporting, it looks very similar to most countries. 70% of large retailers export, 5% of micro retailers export. 70%, it's actually 70 retailers. Whereas 5% is, whereas you have almost 60,000 micro retailers. So if you would have 70% of micro, small, and medium-sized retailers exporting, you would have 41,000. That's six times today. And from the data we were giving, Katie and I, small businesses can reach 28 different countries. So there you have two elements of a goal. 70% of your micro, small, and medium, and then a number of countries they should be reaching. What you then need to do is a little very similar to what we've heard here, approach them. Two sides to that. One is awareness raising. Raising awareness among micro and small businesses of the opportunities of exporting, of how internet and technology can help them. So we are, for example, partnering with US Department of Commerce, and that is awareness raising. But you also need, I think, to actually identify and approach a number of those retailers. You can't grab all 41,000 and involve them, but you can form physical or virtual groups, and there you start, and they become sort of guinea pigs or landmarks of what can be done. One example is a project in Morocco where, supported by the government, a cooperative has been founded involving sellers that want to sell online internationally. And right now, several hundred sellers across Morocco are part of this cooperative, so they're part of a virtual group leveraging internet for exporting. Or you can do as in a German town we've been working with recently, the town wanted to bring their merchants online and then figured out how can we do that and contacted a partner. you have 80 merchants working together in different sectors, but figuring out together how they can leverage online. So I think it's the goal, it's reaching out to those sellers in different ways. It's then, I think, in my view, addressing four areas. How do you make them global visible? How do you address payments for them? How do you address efficient delivery for them? And there was a fourth, which I can't remember right now. And doing so, you will need to involve partners. And that makes your trade policy something that spans several different policy areas and involves partners, something perhaps Cathy can sort of evolve, talk about in the context of the E-Trade for All initiative. But I think it's crucial to involve partners and do this practically. And when you do so, final word, Torbjörn, when you do so, when you implement a project, when you together with the identified sellers try to address these areas, that's when you will actually identify the issues, the barriers. There might be export restrictions, such as you can't get an export approval unless you get the funds in advance. There might be payment issues. There might be currency exchange thresholds, making it difficult to pay for the type of services Anupam were talking about. And those things you will identify when you, in practice, try and implement this.
I'm going to pass on immediately here to Cathy, because to have your perspectives here on, in your first intervention, you spotted three areas sort of that you thought was particularly important here. But what about the policy side here? What do you see as the priorities that we should focus on?
Yeah, it's a great question on priorities. All of us have different views on this, and there are so many priorities that I think we also have to think very strategically what to prioritize, in what sequence, what should go this year, what should go next year, and so forth. To me, you know, if we're looking at particularly empowering their small businesses and this online trade revolution, whether it's in goods or services, something that Hanne mentioned on online payments is we've had an explosion of online payments platforms around the planet. There are more payments platforms than there are countries today. At the same time, when you look under the hood, these payment platforms oftentimes don't interoperate. So you may be a seller in sub-Saharan Africa or here in South America, you're selling something to a customer in France and you cannot transact because you're using different payment platforms. My understanding is that Brazil sorted this out internally, domestically here, and you have interoperability of payment platforms, if I'm not mistaken. But at the global level, we still lack this. And I think it would be very powerful to have a global agreement on online payments. Simply to connect these and bring the financial regulators and the trade policymakers together, because a lot of this revolves around financial regulations and the rather parochial interest or different interest that the financial regulators have. The second area is perhaps this trade in low value items. A lot of the stuff that's being shipped by sellers on eBay and other platforms are low value packages. And this has been an absolute explosion if you look at data on of these kind of trade, low-value item trade. Meanwhile, governments have done precious little in facilitating this kind of trade. So a lot of it still gets jammed in customs, has taxes on it and so forth. And one idea that I've been advocating is, including with some colleagues from eBay, is a global agreement, maybe a plurilateral agreement among some countries to raise the threshold under which goods pass duty-free to markets. And possibly we could do something here in Latin America, maybe with countries like Costa Rica who have been constructive players in this, to raise these levels and have everybody do this. Everybody gets more trade for their SMEs because all their neighbors are raising these levels. More stuff passes through customs more easily. Everybody also gives a little bit to their neighbors in this sense. And then the third area that I would highlight is all these regulations, like intellectual property, big deal when you have designs and 3D printable products, kind of designs and models circulating in trade, and all kinds of IP issues and the data flow issue. And one kind of bigger idea, if I may venture, is maybe we could have another Washington Consensus type agreement. Maybe we should rebrand that something like Seoul Consensus to celebrate Korea's ascendance to the leaders of a digital economy, but some kind of rules of the road, codes of conduct for countries to follow and for NGOs or academics to keep countries' feet to the fire about the digital economy and how countries are fueling this. It's very difficult to come up with hard law agreements in this space, and it's not necessarily even beneficial because technologies change so fast. So we have to change the technology of doing trade policy, essentially, and have much more flexible ways of doing this. But I think there's a lot of fragmentation and the risk of kind of balkanization of international trade regulations when it comes to the digital world. And perhaps we could have a more of a global code of conduct in this area and term it, as you might, list of 10 principles that all countries should follow and we may have a better way to monitor and shape this agenda going forward.
That's a brilliant bridge to the multilateral perspective here. For Minister Mora, I just want to remind us and also inform you that the only thing that is moving faster than technology right now is the clock here on stage. So please, Minister Mora.
Thank you, Torben. Let's see, I had 5 years of my life working with Torben in the guise of the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development, the UNTAD. And the spirit in the UNTAD is the spirit of cooperation, of working together, of pushing and doing all we can to move forward as a society, as a global society. And then, when I was appointed in this position, I moved to the World Trade Organization. And I found a completely different environment there, where everyone is defending, everyone is not in the mood of working together. Theoretically, it is, but practically, it is not. So, in the moving in the direction, I start trying to analyze a little bit what the windows of opportunities are here. I have a privilege also to be the coordinator of the accession process that Costa Rica is going through with the OECD. So we hope to become an OECD member by 2018. And I have to be, I'm in charge of the process and moving everyone to go forward. So having now the privilege of being the interface of my country with the UNTAD, with the OECD, and with the World Trade Organization, with the UNTAD, we start, I came back to the UNTAD to support my ideas. And then we found a very interesting window of opportunity in the Nairobi meeting, ministerial meeting of UNTAD, this July, last July. So I met with ministers of Kenya and Pakistan, and we agree that we need to do something. And so we decided, with the support of the UNTAD, to create this idea of the Friends for the E-commerce for Development, which intends to be a group of countries, like-minded countries, that are committed with the SMEs, committed with the e-commerce as a tool, committed with the idea that we need to lower barriers, that we need to remove obstacles, and do all we can to raise the bar at the multilateral system, placing this topic as one of the important topics in the agenda of the ministers and the agenda of the World Trade Organization. My first visit as Minister of Foreign Trade was to Geneva, and I met Roberto Acevedo, who you know well. And I exposed these ideas to Roberto, and he was he told me these are fresh ideas in the World Trade Organization. These ideas plus the green, how the environment will be managed in the trade discussion in the multilateral level, are two areas that have been laid down, and we need as a society to leverage. So I think, that the colleagues from governments that are sitting in this hall. Bring the messages to your authorities. Let's try to move in this direction. The World Trade Organization cannot continue to be just a forum to discuss tariffs, which is basically what is happening. Some practices or some initiatives in the trade facilitation are moving forward, which is great. But a number of other topics in the international trade need to be addressed by the organization and by the multilateral system. So, in my capacities and the momentum we have, I think this is a good way to promote the next step and to have the influence into the system. Where we are going to land, I really don't know. My ambition is to see something like a e-trade agreement, global agreement on the WTO, or at least a plurilateral type of approach, where a group of countries will come together and do significant progress to show the world that this is possible.
Thank you so much. We have very little time left, and I think we would, of course, have liked to have much more time for interaction with the audience. Can I just see an indication of how many questions there might be? We have one half cooked one there, and then one real there. Okay, so there are basically two questions. So I have to ask the organizers, are we allowed, or how tight are we on time? We have 2 minutes. So in that case, I'm going to ask the two questions. Let's stick to 2 minutes as well. So 1 minute per question. And since you were the fastest, although it was half cooked, can Andy Wickoff from the OECD here have a microphone, or? Yeah, it's coming up here. It's coming.
It's faster. Thank you very much. I have a question because I'm a little confused. Many of you, particularly Minister Moore, have talked about the need for special trade policies to recognize different sizes of firms, small especially. But when I listen to Hannah, I get the notion that this technology means that these small firms can now scale and go globally the way we've never seen before. So you got firms like Snapchat, something my teenager uses too much, that, 350 million photos per day, but has 30 employees and is global. So do our trade policies need to change to maybe get away from this size orientation?
Thank you, Andy. And there was a question here also from the gentleman. And if I can also ask you to introduce yourself. Please, sir.
Okay, you have mentioned about bringing the raw material into Brazil and making the finished product and sell in this country. Now, all of a sudden, this online trading is basically you bring the finished product into every country and sell. So basically, you're taking part of the original, you're part of the destination, converting into finished product, economic labors. You wipe it out and move this labor force into the original country. So has the panel discussed about tax issues on a global basis? Because I have not heard that yet. In any Google.com I research have not touched about these tax issues on a global basis, because when the online volume become a certain volume, explosive volume, you're talking about, I like the idea about this online trade agreement, okay? But when this volume getting very big, the tax become issue getting too much, then you're talking about Ireland, talking about how about my income tax in the past, right? 15 years.
Okay. Thank you. The point. Great question. So we have two great questions here, and I'm going to encourage, I definitely want to ask Anupam for the tax question, but maybe Minister Moore would like to touch upon that as well. But how about, Cathy, why don't you start with the Andy's always provocative questions?
Well, I think it's a great question, and I don't think any of us have necessarily advocated an SME trade policy, because this is hard to administer, number one. And number two, it is discriminatory, potentially, and against larger companies who also may sell, say, low-value items across borders. So we cannot differentiate between firm size. To me, that's not the right policy to go. We perhaps want to then, at the local level, do what Minister Mora is talking about, empower SMEs in different ways, provide them the capabilities that they don't have as small players as the large companies have. But to me, you know, if we're having a policy, say, for low-value items, then let's have it for everybody, right? And empower that.
So how many of you have heard of Flappy Bird? Flappy Bird. So it was one person working in Vietnam who created an app that became the best seller around the world, right? That's the power of this kind of technological infrastructure. You can have a small shop that suddenly produces a product that's so widely loved that it's downloaded all over the world, right? So you're absolutely right, Andy, that you know, smaller companies can now serve hundreds and millions of people. Craigslist, an American company, has something like 40 employees reviewing, quote unquote, you know, hundreds of millions of postings, right? So you're absolutely right that small scale enterprises can do very large scale things. And I think we need to recognize that, and you need to think about that, empowering that in your own country and valuing small scale enterprise. I don't think trade law has to be written for small scale enterprises. I do think there are de minimis exceptions that trade law needs to have. And so I encourage those things that the trade facilitation agreement, et cetera, have been doing. But I think it needs to be written for generally. The tax question is a very difficult one. Obviously, companies should be taxed appropriately across the world. We shouldn't be double taxing companies. We should be taxing them appropriately. There are very complicated tax principles to deal with these things, and within the time left, I have no ability to
Minister Mora, 30 seconds response.
Three quick comments. First, Andy, we have to keep in mind that we have, I see like three type of economies. The legacy economy, where the utilization of technology is still a big issue. The economy that is the new economy that we see today, and the economy to be, the one that we still can't even imagine. So how to manage from the public policy point of view, different policies to address this different three contexts is something that I think we need still to work and to build up. We don't know how to do it, honestly. Regarding taxes, taxes are tools for development. So a balance have to be there. So you have to balance short-term and long-term. You have to balance local economy, the consumer, and the companies. And this is not easy. And in fact, we're coming from very rigid legislations. So all this, the world of taxes has to be somehow redefined, and that globalization will gradually probably push governments towards that object.
Hanne, I'm sorry, I'm going to have to cut here because otherwise I will be shot by the organizers. Is it okay? Okay.
Yeah.
You're much better at negotiation.
Because it feels so unfair. No, so just very quickly, I agree with Katia said. It's not about creating special rules for micro, small, and medium size. It's taking the framework, say the trade facilitation agreement, and then thinking about the application. So how do you apply, for example, trusted trader programs so that they work for small businesses? Now they aren't being used by small businesses. So I think it's in the application. Another example is just nationally, when you have a very different type of trade, you need to look at the trust creation between authorities and these huge number of small companies. So you don't put in place burdens such as you have to apply with certain requirements before you do business, rather than you do business and then you account for what you've done.
Thank you so much, Hani. So this concludes this session, and I would like first that you all give the panelists a big applause, because they've done a great job here, I think so. If this one is still on. There is a new initiative just launched called E-Trade for All. And this is, I think, a great platform that we will be able to use both among the international organization, governments, and the private sector entities to help developing countries catch up in this area. I'm very happy that WITSA is a member of this initiative. We're very proud to have them on board. And I hope that we, in the coming year, will be able to work more with the WITSA members in the respective countries to see how they can also contribute in this effort. With that, again, thanks so much to WITSA and to the Brazilian hosts for having allowed us to have this discussion today. I regret that we didn't have more disagreement among the panelists. We just nodded and were happy, all of us. But it was a great time for us, and I hope you enjoyed it too. Thank you very much.